So the let's see, let's make sure we get everybody on here. And I think right now the most important person that I want to make sure we get on is Amy. And because Amy is going to kick things off by telling us a little bit about CarePatrol, and then we'll get to meet all the other team members and learn about where they're from and their locations, what have you. So let's see. Amy, are you on there yet?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Yeah, Amy, you want to kick things off and give the audience a little overview of what CarePatrol is all about?
Sure thing. Thanks, Steve. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us today. I'm Amy Fager, and my husband Gary and I are owners of CarePatrol of Delaware and Maryland Eastern Shore. And we've been in business for almost 6 years now. And we absolutely love what we do. We love helping the seniors in our communities. CarePatrol is a national senior advisory and placement service. We are a free service to the community. And CarePatrol actually has close to 150 offices across the country. I don't know if you all knew that, but in Maryland alone, I think we have 6 or 7. So we are growing strong. So what CarePatrol does is we help seniors find safe living options. I should say seniors and their families and friends find safe living options such as assisted living, memory care, and independent living. So with that, we have toured all of those the assisted living and memory care communities in our area. And when we take a tour of the communities, we are making note of things like the price, of course, but also their amenities, their care capabilities, because some assisted livings can handle a higher level of care than others. And then also we check the care and violation history reports of the places that we recommend. So we have done, you can see, we've pretty much done all the legwork for you. Families and friends of our clients really appreciate our service because of that. So CarePatrol uses a three-step process when we meet with our clients. We consult, educate, and advocate. The consultation is usually done in person if we can. With COVID these days, we've had to do Zoom calls or phone calls, but we do like to meet our clients in person. And when we meet with the clients, of course, we're gonna find out what the care needs are, medical history, but we also wanna get an idea of what the client's likes and dislikes are. Find out a little about them. Do they have children? Do they have a pet that they love dearly? And what did they do before they retired? So we try to get a little information about them so that we can help match a community to their needs and their likes. Also, if a client needs to move out of the area or out of the state, we can help with that because, as I mentioned, we have 150 offices across the country and we can help with that transition. Secondly, we educate our clients. We talk about the basic things like the differences between the types of cares. What is the difference between assisted living and memory care and skilled nursing? In fact, we hand out a folder to all of our clients that we meet in person. There is a four-page handout there that describes those types of care and also a lot of other pertinent information. Also, when we're talking about the budget, we talk about financial resources and benefits that may be available, such as VA aid in attendance or even a county subsidy. We try to help to put the pieces together to help them figure out how to pay for the care. And lastly, we advocate for our clients. If it is assisted living or memory care, we would recommend a few places, 3 or 4 places. We would set up the tours for you. We would pick you up if you need transportation. A lot of our seniors that we work with don't have family members nearby. So a lot of times we pick them up, take them on the tour, and be their advocate through the whole process. Make sure they're looking for the right things, asking the right questions, and getting their questions answered. We also have a database of resources available, elder law attorneys, financial planners, movers, organizers, downsizing companies, all sorts of information to help help the seniors. Also, just wanted to mention that we do have a 5-star rating on Trustpilot. If you're not familiar with Trustpilot, just go to trustpilot.com and you can see all of the reviews that all of our clients across the 150 offices that we have, that we have maintained a 5-star rating, and we are all really very proud of that. So if you have anybody that you know that could use our help, please reach out to one of the Care Patrol offices. And even if you have someone that just needs an education, we're there to give that information. And you know, maybe they don't need that that help right now, but later on down the road. I heard from somebody last week that kept my number from 3 years ago, and now they need some information and help on care. So please let us know if we can help you.
Great. Well, that was great. And what a great resource y'all are providing. And now's my favorite part, is where we go around the Brady Bunch squares and get to know some of the Care Patrol team members. So let's see, I'm going to start with Cindy Evans on my right. And Cindy.
Hi, good afternoon. Thanks for coming, everyone. I'm Cindy Yar Evans, and my territory is southeast and southwest Baltimore County and Anne Arundel County.
Great. And then below Cindy, we've got Robin Edwards.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Robin Edwards. I'm with Care Patrol of Northern Virginia, and I serve Fairfax, Arlington, Alexandria, and part of Prince William County.
Excellent. And then below, we've got Bonnie Danker.
Good afternoon. I'm Bonnie, and I have the area for Montgomery County, Howard County, and myself and Charles and Robin all go into the district. So we're excited that you're with us today, and we're excited to have these wonderful presenters.
Great. And then next to Bonnie, why is it blocked on my screen here? Star, sorry. Whoops, let me unmute you, Star. Star, unmute yourself. There you go.
Hi, I'm Star Sowers, and I work with Bonnie Danker in Howard and Montgomery counties. It's good to see everybody today. Thank you for joining us.
Great, and we've already done Amy, so we've got Paula Sotier.
Hi, everyone. My name is Paula Sotier, and I cover Baltimore and Hartford County and Baltimore City. Welcome.
And then above Paula, we've got Jessica.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jessica Pinkert. I work with Bonnie Elliott through Care Patrol of Central Maryland and Loudoun, Virginia. I live in Eldersburg, covering Carroll County for her.
Great. And last but not least, the center square. I just love saying this every month. We've got Charles.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Care Patrol presentation. I'm the Care Patrol representative in Prince George's County. And as Bonnie mentioned, I share the District of Columbia with her and Robin Edwards. And I also manage Charles County. Nice to see you all.
Great. And then before we put everybody behind the curtain, I know we all want to give a big thank you to Visiting Angels for supporting this month's discussion. And we've got Samantha on here. Samantha, you want to tell us a little bit about Visiting Angels?
Hi. So I'm with Visiting Angels, and we do everything from companion care all the way up to personal care, as well as working with hospice. So we help provide the clients with end of life if they need help with bathing, dressing, or if it's just a matter of companionship or whatever the family's needs may be.
Great. And now, Samantha, Visiting Angels is nationwide and you have offices all
Correct.
Over, just like Care Patrol. But what region does your specific office serve?
So we cover all the way from Tawnytown down to the Bay Bridge, as well as DC, Montgomery, some of Montgomery County, some of PG County, Anne Arundel County, Baltimore County, some of Baltimore City, Howard County. So we cover a pretty wide variety.
Great, excellent. Well, thanks for supporting us, the Care Patrol discussion, and be sure to drop in your contact info. I've got it on the screen. I think I dropped it in earlier, but so everybody can reach out and connect with you. And okay, so I'm real excited about the program that you guys put together this month. So I guess now it's time for the Care Patrol team to go behind the curtain and our presenter. Oh, and actually, Samantha, did you have a door prize that you were going to be giving out today?
I do not. I do have my cards and I can get them to you for anybody that wants them and some brochures.
Okay, no worries. Okay, so great. So just throw your contact in. Care Patrol, if they can duck behind the screen now. I'm real excited to meet your presenters who are going to talk about estate planning and protecting the retirement dream. And that's Walt Stundick and Michael Dooley. And I think we've got you two on the screen here. And let me just clear the deck. Welcome. It's great to meet you, and I'm really excited to hear your presentation today, and I know our audience is as well. And just to remind our audience, this is can be interactive. So if you have questions on the topics that Walt and Mike are going to be talking about, by all means, type them in, and we will get to them. But Walt and Mike, tell us a little bit about yourselves before we dive into this discussion today.
Sure. Thanks so much, Steve, for that fantastic introduction. It's been a pleasure getting to know the Care Patrol organization. And thanks for taking the time to join us today. I want to thank Bonnie Elliott for giving Mike and I the opportunity to present to you today. As I mentioned, it's been a pleasure working with the organization. I find it fascinating how broad the organization is with throughout the geographic area. So my name is Walt Stundick. I'm a financial advisor with Edward Jones Investments in Annapolis. I have 23 years of investment experience in the financial planning and investment management industry. I started my investment practice with Edward Jones in 2014, and I've worked for some outstanding organizations, including Legg Mason, T. Rowe Price, Raymond James, and also the Department of Defense. My investment practice provides investment management expertise in the area of stocks, bonds, mutual funds, life insurance, and long-term care to our clients. We specialize in all aspects of retirement planning. Someone I should mention that's critical to my investment practice that is on the call today is Connie Holliday. So Connie is my branch office administrator, and she plays as much of a role in the investment practice and the efficiency of the practice as I do, for sure. So our topic for today, long-term care. So long-term care represents one of the greatest risks to your financial security. Steve, were you going to ask a question?
No, I'm just going to duck. Michael, tell us a little bit about your background, then I'm going to duck behind the curtain and just remind the audience that they can ask questions throughout. Perfect. Give us a little overview of your background, Michael.
Well, I'll let Walt continue. I think.
Then that's great. Okay, so I'm behind the curtain. You guys take the driver's seat here.
I think Walt was going to introduce me if I'm.
I am going to introduce Mike, so no problem there, Steve. So as I mentioned, long-term care represents one of the greatest risks to your financial security. Not only is long-term care expensive, but the cost of long-term care continues to rise across the country. So today I'm accompanied by Mike Dooley. Mike is a subject matter expert in the area of long-term care. He is a certified financial planner and accredited estate planner. Mike and I work closely to be sure we provide objective and individualized advice and solutions to meet your financial needs. Please reach out to me or Mike if I can be of service to you or your family. With that, I'm going to turn things over to Mike to introduce himself a little bit more specifically and then start the presentation.
Thanks, Walt. I guess I would just say that I've been in the business, in the financial services business, for a little over 30 years. As Walt said, I'm a certified financial planner and accredited estate planner. And I'm a partner or a consultant to Edward Jones. So I work closely with the financial advisors in the area of insurance planning, asset protection planning, and estate planning. Edward Jones has a system set up in a very intelligent way. There's actually three of me, and the advisors get to choose who they work with based on who they feel is they're most compatible with, based on things like trust, competence, likability, service, etc. So with that said, I don't want to talk a lot about myself. Let's go ahead and get started and talk a little bit about long-term care planning. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. That's all right. Hopefully this will work. Okay. So today's topic is protecting the retirement dream. Now, first thing I would say is there are many aspects to retirement planning, but in my mind, there are two major aspects. The first being the accumulation phase, making sure that you accumulate enough assets and or pension money so that you can retire with plenty of income. We want you to be able to retire and live a long, long life and not have to worry about income. But there's a second phase to that, which is protecting and securing that retirement from the risks in retirement. And what are the risks? Think about it. You just look forward and you got the market, right? You got taxes, we want to be tax smart. And today we're going to talk about the risks of healthcare costs or medical expenses. That's the big one. That's the big eroder, if that's a word, of your retirement assets. So first and foremost, let's see, is this thing working? I got to read this disclaimer so that I stay compliant. No representation or warranty expressed or implied is made by AGL or its affiliates as to the completeness of the information provided. This material is general in nature, was developed for educational use only, and is not intended to provide financial, legal, fiduciary, accounting, or tax advice, nor is it intended to make any recommendations. Applicable laws and regulations are complex and subject to change. Please consult your financial professional regarding your situation. For legal, accounting, and tax advice, consult the appropriate professional. Policies issued by American General Life Company, Houston, Texas, except in New York, were issued by the United States Life Insurance Company in the city of New York. Issuing companies AGL and US Life are responsible for the financial obligations of insurance products and are members of the American International Group, AIG. Guarantees are backed by the claims paying ability of the issuing company. The products may not be available in all states and product features may vary by state. Having said that, this is an AIG presentation, but through Edward Jones, they represent a number of different insurance companies. So protecting the retirement dream. So you've worked hard to prepare for a successful transition into the best part of your life, retirement. And for 80 to 90% of our clients, the number one goal is retirement income. We want to make sure that they have plenty of money in retirement so that if they live a long, long life, they have nothing to worry about. But there's a second part to retirement planning, which is securing and protecting your retirement. And we want to have a meaningful conversation about that. Too many people accumulate assets, have enough assets, assuming nothing goes wrong, to live out their retirement years, and they have a long-term care need, and it really depletes their assets. We recommend different strategies to help mitigate that risk. Okay, so we're getting older in this country, right? More than 10,000 people are turning 65 every day. In 2024, the U.S. will have more than 65-year-olds than ever before. And it was 2011 where the first baby boomers first turned 65. And as of 2019, there were 54 million Americans 65 years of age or older. So 30 million women and 24 million men. And the average life expectancy is 19.6 years. So we're living longer, which creates obviously more risk and more medical expenses. Medical expenses cost more than you anticipated. The average couple, 65 years or older, will spend more than $600,000 in medical expenses during their lifetime. Older Americans have pulled an estimated $22 billion from long-term savings to pay for their long-term care over the course of a year. It's a big industry. It's a big risk. It's great that we're living longer, but we have to plan for the fact that we're now living longer. Now, one thing that people ask a lot is, what does it cost? What is the cost of services? And there's a website, www.genworth.com, that you can go to, and they have a cost of care estimator. And it's pretty neat. I actually have it on my phone. You can go to your state and then pick a city nearby, and it will give you the median cost of home care, adult daycare, assisted living care, and skilled nursing care, both private and semi-private rooms. So I encourage you to maybe make a mental note of that, or write that down, and you can get an idea of what the services cost in your area. This is a statistic that's mentioned a lot in our industry. 52% of Americans reaching age 65 will need some type of long-term care in their lifetime. It's not like your house burning down. I don't know what the statistics are on that, but they're pretty low. It's a big risk. So if I'm sitting in front of a couple and they're 65 years or older, I can basically say statistically, one of you is gonna need care. Now, they may end up that either one of them needs care or both of them need care, but statistically, one of them is going to. And actually, the way the numbers play out, it's a much higher risk for women than it is for men. For women, it's close to 70%, and men, it's in the low 40s. Men tend to have, more heart attacks or what have you, and pass away. Also, 49% retire earlier than expected due to job loss, health issues, caring for an aging parent, which if you've ever done, is very, very difficult. My mother-in-law has brain cancer right now, and it is an extreme tax on the family. So unexpected long-term care expenses have a major impact on your assets. I mentioned the Genworth calculator. That's more specific to the cost in your area, but these are the average costs for nationwide. You're looking at over $100,000 a year in nursing home care. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that's what you're going to need. Most people want to stay at home, and that runs around $50,000 a year. I remember my grandmother, most people think they want to stay at home, but she didn't. She went to adult daycare because she felt isolated at home. And brought a lot of entertainment to her life. So these are the different costs for the different types of care. And one thing that is important to understand is the government is not set up to help. Medicare will pay some of the cost, depending on the situation, 100% of the first 20 days and part of the next 80 days, you have assuming you're getting better, there are a lot of stipulations. But I think at least in 2020, the copayment for those second 80 days was $176 a day. So it's very expensive. Now we do have Medicaid. Medicaid is for the poor. So you have to become poor in order to be able to access that, which basically means you have to spend down your assets. So proper planning and smart planning and dynamic planning is important. Since 2004, the portion of people 62 plus with financial debt has increased steadily. Okay, the amount of time that you're gonna spend needing long-term care services is might be longer than you think. It might be shorter than you think. The average is 3 years, but it's different for women and for men. For women, it's 3.7 years. Now, this is the full continuum of long-term care services, not just nursing home. And for men, it is 2.2 years. So that gives you an idea of the amount of time that on average that people need long-term care. So what you're seeing here, I think, just to kind of reiterate, is that women are a bit higher risk. They have, on average, a longer stay, a longer need, and they also have a higher risk to actually need the long-term care services. Now, one of the big things is, my grandfather had Alzheimer's, and that's a big deal. Alzheimer's and dementia are one of the leading reasons for people needing access to long-term care services. 1 in 10 people age 65 has Alzheimer's, age 65 plus, has Alzheimer's or dementia. Now, this is important. 16 million Americans provide unpaid care for people with Alzheimer's or dementia. So there's a lot of family members out there taking care of their parents and providing this care for free. The caregivers provided an estimated 18.6 billion hours valued at $244 billion. There are actually plans out there, they're called indemnity plans, that will pay family members. Essentially, they don't pay the family members, but they're not reimbursement. You don't have to use a long-term care licensed agency. They just write you a check each month, and you can use it however you wish. Now, if you wish to pay a family member who may be cutting down on their work hours or balancing work with care, you're more than willing more than able to do so. Okay, and this is what I alluded to earlier. Long-term care impacts extended family members. About 71% of the care is in the home. Like I said earlier, most people want to stay home. Like my grandmother, who wanted to get out. 60% of caregivers juggle their caregiving with work, which is very, very difficult. As I said, we're kind of going through that right now in my family. It's even worse because my mother-in-law is out of state, which means we're driving back and forth from Carolina to Maryland a lot. And 20% of caregivers have reported impacts on their job, meaning they take less hours, they take a lower paying job, or they just quit work altogether. So this not only impacts you and maybe your spouse, but also the other people in your family that that may spend the time to take care of you. Now, we're getting better at helping people live longer. Deaths from heart disease have decreased by 7.3%, while deaths from Alzheimer's have increased 145% between 2000 and 2019. And cancer has also decreased 27% between 2000 and 2019. So death from Alzheimer's is becoming a big, big deal. Seniors die with Alzheimer's, 1 in 3 seniors, with either Alzheimer's or some other type of dementia. These diseases kill more than breast cancer and prostate cancer combined. This is another statistic on long-term care. But what can you do to protect your retirement dream. So what will we do about this? That's the question that's being begged. Well, the first thing you might want to do is to secure and protect your assets is make an appointment with your Edward Jones financial advisor. That would be Walt. Prior to the appointment, you gather and organize your financial documents in one place. Bring your family together to discuss financial and medical plans. We do a lot of this planning, or I should say Walt does. I'm just kind of the sidekick that helps. Walt is the quarterback and the financial planner. I just specialize in a certain area. Here are the different documents that you would want to bring: bank and brokerage account information, medical and durable powers of attorney, wills, insurance policies. And I would add to that any investment statements, because it all, we plan very holistically. And one part of your plan has an effect on another part of the plan. So, okay, so how can you solve your long-term care expense, this risk? What can you do about it? Well, you could use your own assets. That's called self-insure. You can take the risk yourself. Then there are traditional long-term care plans in the market, which are pay as you go, kind of use it or lose it, kind of like car insurance. You pay a premium, you have a certain daily or monthly benefit. And if you have a long-term care need, it will obviously pay that benefit. If you don't and you just pass away, that money is gone. But it's the same thing as car insurance or homeowner's insurance. If you don't get in an accident or your home doesn't burn down, the money stays with the insurance company. But there are also other more dynamic type plans in the market called hybrids or life insurance with a long-term care rider. Essentially what they do, I like to say, it keeps all the money in the family. They're essentially life insurance policies that allow you to access the entire death benefit for long-term care. So if you have a $200,000 policy, everybody's familiar with the fact that if you pass away, the beneficiary receives the $200,000. However, with these plans, you can also use that $200,000 to help fund long-term care expenses should the need arrive. If you have an indemnity plan, like I talked about earlier, they'll just pay you, it's 4 or 5% of the death benefit a month. And so say it was 5%, you get $10,000 a month, and you could use that money however you wish, paying a licensed agency or paying a family member or a neighbor. You can do whatever you wish. That talks about the funding options. And what we do is we tailor the recommendation to the individual client. There's not a cookie cutter approach. Every client situation is different. That's what makes actually our job interesting, in my opinion. So every client, we have to get to know them. We have to get to know their financial situation along with their family dynamics in order to tailor a strategy, which is going to help mitigate the risk of long-term care while maintaining your current lifestyle. That's very important. Any recommendations that we make should not affect your desired income in retirement. So we like to say that our clients just continue doing what they're doing like nothing happened. We just move money around in different positions so that we're properly allocated to mitigate the risk of long-term care. And there are an array of tools and materials we can help to make the right decisions at Edward Jones. So I think I need to read this as another disclaimer. An accelerated death benefit rider is not a replacement for a long-term care insurance. That's what I just mentioned, the accelerated death benefit. It is a life insurance benefit that gives you the option to accelerate some of the death benefit in the event the insured meets the criteria for a qualifying event described in the policy. Death benefits and policy values, such as cash values, premium payments, cost of insurance charges, if applicable, will be reduced if an ABR payment is made. ABR payments may be limited by the contract or by outstanding policy loans. They're all different, but essentially what happens is, if in my example, if you take the $10,000 a month, now you have $190,000 left. And then you take another $10,000, you have $180,000. If you pass away, $180,000 goes to your family as a death benefit. If you exhaust it all, then the full $200,000, then you've used it. There is no death benefit. But that's one of the three ways that we strategize to mitigate long-term care risk. And I guess I probably should have stopped at some point. I get talking and asked if there were any questions, Steve. I apologize for that.
No, no worries. Well, we got a few that came in. First was someone was hoping that you might be able to share your slide deck. And I copied your email address into the chat there, but I also want to just remind everybody that we recorded this. And then let's see, somebody asked, so do you offer the hybrid long-term care insurance policy and the indemnity plans?
Yes, yeah, we do.
Maybe explain for those that might not be aware of what that product is.
How about if I give you an example?
Great.
I thought maybe I would do this. This is a real life client. I've changed the name to Mr. Jones. He's 61 years old. This is like my fact finder. Single, has three children. Health is good. He inherited $500,000 from his aunt. He's currently working. But he has a pension coming to him of around $4,000 and Social Security of $2,900. And that is going to cover most of his expenses in retirement. He might need another $1,000 a month, but he's not going to need a whole lot from his assets in retirement. So, because remember, priority one is that he has his desired income in retirement. And anything that we recommend should not jeopardize that. So he's projected to have $1.9 million when he passes away. So we know there's money that can be moved around. So here's what his situation looks like. He's got qualified assets, which are IRA money, essentially. He's got non-qualified assets, which are stocks and bonds, and then he owns a home. Okay, now I consider all of this our offense. Okay, this is the money that we're trying to grow. However, one thing that people miss in planning is that I mentioned three risks earlier, the market, taxes, and medical expenses. Well, they're all correlated, okay? Because if you have a stroke, one of the first things you're gonna do is call your financial advisor and say, how am I gonna pay for this? And what's he gonna or she gonna look at? They're gonna look at, where's the market and what are the tax ramifications? So, I mean, my former mother-in-law had a stroke in 2008 during the financial crisis. She had a lot of IRA money. So it was a disaster because she had to pull money out and pay taxes on money at the exact wrong time. What I like to say is she wasn't properly allocated or diversified for the risks in this part of her financial life cycle, the retirement life cycle. If she had another bucket, then she would have been able to access that bucket. So this client had a portfolio of stocks and bonds, and he had quite a bit of bonds. And what we did was we took from this non-qualified account, we took $40,000 a year for 3 years, and we created this $300,000 death benefit / long-term care benefit. So he was moving $120,000. $300,000 was his benefit guaranteed. If he passed away, $300,000 goes to his beneficiary. If he had a chronic illness, he could pull 4% or $12,000 a month from the $300,000. And what I asked him was, how long do you think it's going to take that $120,000 of bonds to equal $300,000? And he kind of laughed. He goes, it probably never will. Might in 20 years, but why not make it, since you have the money to plenty of money for income and retirement, why not just move some money around and make that $120,000, $300,000 today? And it's a very simple concept, but most people aren't aware of that these products exist. They're more familiar with the traditional long-term care policies where you pay, which are pay as you go. And this is why I like to say the money stays in the family, because he's moving $120,000, $300,000 is coming back to the family, in the form of care or a death benefit or a combination of the two. It's not a net cost.
Just a deferment. A follow-up question is, what is qualified and non-qualified?
Qualified money is money that's inside an IRA or a retirement plan. Non-qualified is outside an IRA. So he had an IRA and 401k that equaled $900,000. Then he had other investments outside of an IRA that were in stocks and bonds.
Okay, great. And let's see, Deb asks, what are some of the indemnity plans that provide reimbursement? Is AFLAC one of them?
I don't think so. I think AFLAC, it's not one of the ones we use, but I think they're more specialty plans like cancer, certain types of disabilities, et cetera. I don't think they're in the long-term care market. But what companies, maybe, is the question? Well, you got Lincoln, Prudential, Protective, AIG, Pacific Life. There's a number of companies that nationwide that have these types of plans.
Okay, great. All right, well, let's see. I am taking a peek here at that. So what I always like to do at this point is say that we got through some of the questions here. Make sure that if you've got any additional questions or comments, just to throw those into the Q&A box, or you can also raise your virtual hand there and I'll bring, let's see. And it looks like we have somebody with their hand raised. Sometimes this is a mistake, but Nick Mason, your hand is raised. I'm not sure if you've got a question or it was just a mistake. Oh, the hand went down. Okay. That's usually the case. While we're waiting to see if there's any additional questions, any sort of closing statements that you or Walt would like to throw in, by all means, throw those in. I want to let the audience know that we do have a door prize that's going to be coming up here. So we're going to be spinning the wheel of names. Okay. And I knew this was going to happen. Can you explain what the 1035 exchange is?
A 1035 exchange is what's called a like-kind exchange. That's exchanging one annuity to an annuity or a life insurance policy that has cash value, moving that cash value from that the particular policy that you own to the other, to a new policy without any tax ramifications. Same thing with an annuity. Now, the interesting thing about a 1035 exchange is you can go from a life insurance policy, the cash value, and 1035 exchange it into an annuity, but you can't go the other way. It's much like a 1031 exchange, if anybody's in real estate, where you exchange one property for another without paying taxes. You sell one, but you buy a like-kind property, and you defer your taxes.
Hey there, Mike. This is Walt. I just wanted to clarify. So you had in your slide there, you mentioned, and I want to do this for the benefit of the audience. I think that we want to, can you be a little bit more specific about what exactly a hybrid life insurance policy is and the differences or similarities between that and an indemnity policy? Are they the same thing? Are they not? Well, are they used interchangeably? If you could just give a little bit more clarity on that, I think it would help them.
They're apples and oranges. In my example, a hybrid basically means that it's a life insurance policy that pays long-term care benefits, and there are different types of hybrids. Now, that plan can be either a reimbursement or an indemnity, okay? So in my example, where we had the $300,000 that we created, that was an indemnity plan, which would pay $12,000 a month. That could have been a reimbursement plan. It was a hybrid that could have been a reimbursement or an indemnity. A reimbursement plan is not that, it sounds worse than it is. It's not like you typically go get receipts and you know, they reimburse you. It's kind of done in the background, like your health insurance through the billing agency. The main difference is that you have to use a licensed agency. Most people do use a licensed agency. So I would not get a policy because it was reimbursement. It's just that the indemnity plans are just, you know, a little bit more flexible. Particularly, I remember meeting one client and she said, my mother had a long-term care insurance policy and we had a neighbor that could have taken care of her and they wouldn't pay the neighbor. And I said, well, if you had an indemnity plan, they would have, or they wouldn't have paid her. They would have paid it to your mother. Your mother could have used the money however she wished.
Great. Okay, lots of questions came in. I knew this was gonna happen. Your reference, Bob asks, you referenced the SECURE Act on your slide. Please explain the significance.
Okay, the SECURE Act, and that example, I think it said something like, is it an issue? No, not for this client. The SECURE Act was passed and came implemented January 1, 2020. Okay, and what it said, the best way to explain it is to explain how it used to be. Prior to the SECURE Act, an IRA beneficiary, a non-spousal IRA beneficiary, so I pass away and my children split my IRA. Well, let's say my son is 40 years old. Well, there was a thing called a single life expectancy table, which would say, all right, he's expected to live to age 76. So he could pull out that money from that IRA over 36 years, 136, 236, 336, et cetera, over 36 years. Well, the SECURE Act changed that. They basically eliminated what we call in our business the stretch. So what it said is a non-spousal beneficiary of an IRA will have to pull out the money within 10 years. Now, they don't have to pull it out every year, but within 10 years, it has to be exhausted. This is a big deal because I call it the triple whammy. And what I mean by that is you have to pull it out within 10 years. Your beneficiaries are likely to be in their peak earning years when they receive it. And most people agree that in the future tax rates are going to be higher. So I had one client, she had a pension. She had all her income covered and she had a $1.38 million IRA and one daughter. It was a second marriage. So all her money was going to her daughter and all her husband's money was going to his two kids. Well, what I had explained to her was that your daughter is going to have to pull this money out within 10 years. So that's going to push her up tax brackets. So we designed a strategy, not only around long-term care, but around the SECURE Act as well, because we wanted to mitigate the lack of diversification she had. She was in a very similar situation as my former mother-in-law that I talked about, because she had all her money in an IRA. So she would have had to grab money out of that. And we don't know where the market would be at the time. but she also had a different issue. And then when she passed away, her daughter was going to have to pull that money out within 10 years. More money was going to go to the government than is needed. So we designed strategies around both the long-term care issue and the Secure Act, the tax issue.
Okay, great. Let's see, got a bunch more here. Okay. John Hinkle says, how well does long-term care insurance with an inflation rider, say 3% compounding inflation, compare for the cost of coverage for a life insurance hybrid with a long-term care insurance rider at an average age of claim onset, ages 80 to 82? Woo! Very complicated question there, but I guess the big question is related to inflation riders and how do they work?
Well, you know, and then with an inflation rider, the benefit goes up every year. Okay, now if you have a traditional long-term care plan, the way to get the most potential long-term care is through a traditional long-term care plan. Okay, that's going to give you the most long-term care coverage. So, and to answer your question, at age 82 or 85, you're going to have the most long-term care coverage in a traditional plan. In what I call like a semi-hybrid, where the death benefit's lower, and the long-term care benefit's higher, you're not going to have as much long-term care benefit. However, like some of them will return your premium if you were just to pass away. The one that I showed an example of is with, you know, the death benefit and the long-term care benefit were the same. And it didn't go up. But what we look at in that case is what's called the internal rate of return. It gets a little complicated, but it basically says if the client invested that $40,000 a year, what rate of return would he have to get at different ages for it to equal $300,000? And so I think, you know, he was 61, probably age 81, he would have to get 4% tax-free. So I like to say there's an umbrella over your account the entire time. It goes up to 300 if you get sick or you pass away. But in the end, if you live a long life and just pass away or get sick at the time, you still get a fair rate of return on your money. But they're two different animals.
Okay. Let's see. Deb asks, and I think because it's on the screen here right in front of her, in your disclosure, it says that accelerated death benefit rider is not a replacement for a long-term care plan. Mm-hmm. And then she follows up and says, I have a hybrid long-term care plan with an accelerated death benefit through AIG. Do you recommend that I get a long-term care policy in addition to the hybrid plan?
No. The reason it's saying that is because when you use the chronic illness or long-term care benefit, it decreases your death benefit. So it's got, and that, see how it says that in there, death benefits and policy values, premiums, costs will be reduced. If you have a hybrid type policy through AIG, it's probably, and I'd have to look at it and see it, you know, but it's probably a good policy that I would keep. And I wouldn't be concerned about adding on to it unless you feel like you don't have adequate coverage. And that's a discussion that we would have through a, you know, some type of consultation.
Okay, great.
But I wouldn't panic over this is what I'm saying.
Okay. Great. And she says yes. And she says, okay, thanks. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Joyce asks, can you explain how long-term care policy provides the opportunity to access cash if necessary?
Well, I'm not sure if I understand the question.
I'm not sure. Maybe at some point.
Well, let me try though, okay, as best I can. How do you access the cash? Well, you're essentially accessing, I mean, in that hybrid type plan, life insurance with the long-term care rider, you're accessing the death benefit. Okay, so the death benefit is 300, which means the chronic illness benefit is 300. So you're accessing cash from that benefit. As you access it, the death benefit goes down. Okay. Now, if your question is, how do you access it? Then you're asking questions about triggers. You know, how is it triggered? And all of them are pretty much the same. It's, you have to, for at least 90 days, not be able to need substantial assistance with your activities of daily living. Substantial assistance means hands-on or standby assistance. Your activities of daily living, think about what you do when you wake up in the morning. You transfer to the bathroom, you bathe, you dress, you feed, toileting, incontinence. 2 out of 6. And that's the physical side, or you have your safety issue because you have dementia or Alzheimer's.
Okay.
Maybe somewhere in there I answered a question.
Okay, good. Let's see, somebody asks, can you talk about overfunding a particular type of life insurance policy, such as an indexed universal life? So one would be paying extra premiums, which creates an account value that can become a loan from a policy, thereby providing income in retirement were to be used for healthcare or long-term care. Boy, we've got an educated audience here.
Well, yeah, that's what's called, we call it a LIRP, a life insurance retirement plan. And essentially there's a maximum amount of money that you can put in per certain death benefit at different ages. We actually solve it the other way around. Let's say somebody wants to save $10,000 a year. Well, we solve for the lowest death benefit that will not ruin the tax advantages, which are tax-free loans, which I think you may have mentioned. So more money is going into the cash value. So it's the opposite. Normally when you buy insurance, you want to buy more coverage for the least amount of money. And this, you flip it upside down. You want to have the least amount of insurance so the costs are as low as possible for the amount that you're putting in. And then that money grows tax deferred. And then you can pull it out in the form of tax-free loans. And if you have a favorable loan rate, some of them are, you know, close to zero. It's like not, some are 0.05, 0.5. It can be a good way to save for retirement. Assuming, you know, there's a philosophy on this, Edward Jones, and I agree with this, is that assuming that you've maxed out your 401k, and if you're, you know, if you're doing one of these plans, you're probably not eligible for a Roth. Usually these plans are done by people that are, their income is substantial and it's their income's too high for a Roth. Or if you have a business and you don't have a retirement plan, or you don't want to include people in your retirement plan, that makes sense. So they can be a powerful vehicle for saving for retirement if used properly. And if the client follows through on the plan, a lot of times what happens is clients stop after a certain period of time.
I'm putting up the wheel of names there just to kind of let everybody know that we're going to try to get through these last questions here. And then if I can get our CarePatrol representative who wants to do the virtual spin, that would be great. Let's see here. Non-spousal IRA beneficiary, 10-year withdrawal rule per CARES applies starting what year?
January 1 of 2020.
Okay, great. So you can provide and write insurance coverage for all states or just certain states in certain locations. I guess that's specifically to you and the Edward Jones team.
That would be the Walt.
Okay. Walt, what's your, what region can you serve?
So great question. We have clients all over the country. I'm licensed to sell securities in many different states. We would look at your particular situation, depending upon which state you're in. And what we would do is we would seek a license for that state, which isn't a difficult process, and we would be able to service you. Something that I wanted to point out that I think is really important is there tends to be a misperception that life insurance or long-term care needs to be funded out of pocket. And a lot of what Mike has talked about today is essentially a reallocation of resources. So we're using your existing assets to actually fund the life insurance and chronic illness policy, and it can be used for either. I think that's an important distinction because a lot of people think when they purchase, or they go into sign off on a life insurance policy with a long-term care chronic illness rider, they have to pay for it out of pocket. That's not the case. It can be paid, the premiums can be paid with IRA assets or with what Mike referred to as non-qualified assets, which are essentially money that's in an individual account, joint account, trust account, what have you, anything outside of an IRA. So I just wanted to make that distinction.
Great. And we got three closing questions here and then we'll spin the wheel. They're from Bob Colson, who's an awesome, he asks the best questions. He's very thought-provoking questions. So first is it best to contact a certified long-term care consultant, a CLTC, about LTC policies?
I don't know how to, I would say it depends. Like I say, you know, I'm a CFP, I'm an accredited estate planner, and I'm, you know, I have the certificates on my wall and everything, but I went through the classes, right? And I passed. So it shows that I have some kind of mental capacity to do this, to take care of people. But I think it depends on the individual. I think what you're looking for.
Yeah, I think that's a great way to answer the question. I think it's these certifications and these credentials are just a starting point. And I think that make sure that when you're talking to somebody, that you talk about their breadth and scope of knowledge, because I guess what you want is not just somebody that sort of checked the box that they got that certification, that they're truly committed to that.
I take my experience much more seriously than I do my letters. And good, I think what you're looking for is two things, integrity and competence.
Mm-hmm.
When you find that person, that in all financial planning, that's the person you want to work with.
And then Bob says, do you recommend using a reverse mortgage to fund long-term care insurance?
I'm not going to touch that.
Oh, okay.
That's a kind of outside my scope. I'm not an expert on reverse
mortgage. Okay. And then his last good one.
Question. Good question. It's just that we got to be careful with what I.
And I think especially, you know, there needs to be more of a consultation to
answer a
question like that. And lastly, he says, some people don't easily medically meet the LTC, long-term care insurance underwriting. So what is their option to fund long-term care insurance?
Well, there's, you know, that's one of the problems is that if you can't, they're going to have to use their own assets in that case. There is, I mean, the other thing you could do is in the old days, we used to do a replenishment strategy, depending on how large your estate is like, let's say we had a couple and neither one of them could, well, there weren't riders, there weren't long-term care benefits. And so what we would do is purchase a second to die policy, which paid out at the second death so they funded it with their assets, and then the second to die replenished the assets at their death. But that's the one thing that it's not as good as having a long-term care rider because it's there when you need it. But if you're uninsurable for that, there's not a whole lot you can do.
Great. And then let's see, the last question, and then we'll spin the wheel of names here. Great, great bunch of questions. Audience.
Yeah, really good question.
So how long does it take for long-term care hybrid life insurance program policy? How long does it take these coverages to get these coverages in place? So I guess if somebody gets the wheel going, how long until they can expect to have a policy?
Well, it takes a while these days. As a matter of fact, Underwriting has been taking an average of 77 days. I just was on a call a day or two ago that somebody mentioned that number. Mainly because a lot of these companies have trimmed down and they're behind in staff, I think because of COVID. But you could expect a couple months. Now, there are plans to get approved in 2 or 3 weeks, but I would say a couple months is what to expect.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Michael and Walt, and to our audience. And if I could get a CarePatrol representative to pop on there, we got Cindy. Cindy, another great discussion. You and your team got a great bunch of experts this month.
Yeah, it was very interesting.
So if you want to raise your hand and spin the virtual wheel, let's see who wins this month. And I believe it is Ardella Ross. Let's see, is Ardella, she's not in the audience anymore. No. Shoot, but we can, I'll make sure that you get the email address for Ardella and can notify her that she won. And I want to thank you and your colleagues, Cindy, for putting together such a great event. I'm looking forward to next month. And Walt and Mike, thanks for your great information. The audience really came through with some excellent thought-provoking questions.
Yeah, thank you.
They did for sure. You were right when you said we had an educated audience. Yeah. So that's fantastic. Well, thank you guys for giving us the opportunity to present. I greatly appreciate it. And if you have any follow-up questions, feel free to reach out to me at my office, and I'll be happy to help you.
Excellent. All right. Well, everybody, we'll see you next month. And again, thanks, CarePatrol.
Take care.
Take care.